Hello and welcome to the Airship 27 podcast number 26. I'm your co-host Rob Davis, here alongside my co-host and captain of the ship,
Captain Ron Fortier. Hi there, Airship 27 fans, loyal airmen, as we like to call you. And as Rob said, this is episode 26, and we're really rolling along with the new year, Rob. Before we get into it, we got quite a few little things to cover this episode. Lots more on the Brother Bones movie and some of our traveling plans, etc. But before we do, we always start off every episode with our own little commercial. And that's the fact that we are proud members of the Comics Podcast Network. You can find every single episode of the Airship 27 podcast on comicspodcast.com every single month. You can also find us on iTunes, Stitcher, Comic Frontline, YouTube, and of course, the Zone4Podcast.com. And you know, Rob, while we're discussing that, I want to take a second to give a shout out to Grant Fowler and the Zone 4 Podcast. Today, April 3rd, is the 8th year anniversary of Zone 4. And that's I think the last time we did an episode, we're into the 300s now. It's like 330 episodes.
Wow.
You believe that?
Yeah. Wow.
Isn't that amazing?
That is amazing.
Yep. Brant and three other comic gentlemen, the whole concept behind Zone 4, for people who don't know, was to start a podcast and just discuss anything comic related, if you will. And so Brant talked to several of his friends online. They decided to do this and create this show. And as it turned out, Rob, all four of them lived in a different time zone when the show first aired.
Uh-huh.
So obviously it was you know, a natural thing to call it Zone 4. Well, over the 8 years of that group, Brant, still the creator and the controller of Zone 4, is the only one still remaining. There have been, I want to say, maybe 7-8 different hosts over the years that have come and gone. Our congratulations to all of them for helping produce such a really, really fun show. As you know, some of our fans here know, these days the current lineup with Brant is yours truly, Gordon Domowski, and Chris Ventura. And it really, really is a lot of fun. It's a great show. And so a tip of the hat to our Sparky for this. And who knows, bro, maybe someday we'll be celebrating the 8th year anniversary of the Airship 27 podcast.
Well, I just realized that somebody sent an email or something mentioning how they had done something with us in 2007. And I went, holy cow, that's 10 years ago. We've been at this more than 10 years now.
Yes, we have. We certainly have. And you know what? One of the things that we enjoy the most about this whole concept of pulp fandom, I'm going to let you start off our show, is the fact that you know, we attend some of the coolest and most enjoyable pulp conventions out there. So why don't you take off with agenda number one?
Yeah, I think we talked about the question last week or last month was about what conventions we go to, and we mentioned this one that's coming up here. But we're packing up for Windy City. With April here, we are packing up the old Airship 27 with lots of books, comics, and other assorted stuff as we prepare our annual trip to the Windy City Pulp and Paper Convention. The show is held in the Chicago suburb of Lombard from Friday, April 21st to Sunday, April 23rd. As we have in the past 7 years, we will be hosting the Pulp Factory Awards presentations on Friday night prior to the big auction. Then on Sunday, Ron will moderate the first morning new pulp panel. If you're anywhere near the Chicago area on that weekend and have never been to a pulp show, please come on down and say hello. Really, if you're within a couple of hours drive, maybe even three, it's worth coming in. If you're a pulp fan, come and see this show. It's a lot of fun.
Yeah, you know, again, we, you know, you and I both at the same time throughout the year, do go and attend regular comic or other media conventions. And we try to tell people how much fun a pulp show is. It's more than just pulps, as you and, you know, I've discovered over the years attending these. It's basically any collectible thing related to the pulps. There are paperback vendors who sell all those classic 60s, 70s, 80s paperbacks, etc. There are magazine guys who sell old copies of Life and Look magazine, original artwork, Rob.
Yeah.
They usually have a display at every show, and some of the most beautiful stuff, some of the rare original pulp paintings.
Yeah, there are even some for sale. I mean, and there are prints of some of those as well. And
right.
There's a couple of guys there that have books that talk about different artists from the pulp era. I'm blanking on the publisher at the moment, but they're also usually there at Windy City. And I,
oh yeah,
they have a new book out. I usually pick it up.
One of the regulars, as you're talking, one of the regulars at the shows, and it's a gentleman you and I have met, and you bought one of his art books, is David Saunders.
Right, that's it. That's what I could pick
up. Because he's the son of Norman Saunders, who was one of the premier pulp artists of the 40s. And eventually Dave did put together a huge, huge art book of his father's paintings. And I know you have a copy of that.
Yes, I do. Absolutely. Beautiful book.
Oh, yeah. Well, Norm was a really, really gifted artist. And incidentally, as it turns out, he did the cover, which is a tie to segue to this. He did the cover to the one and only original Captain Hazard pulp magazine.
That's right.
Which, as our loyal airmen know, is a series that I later picked up when you and I got Airship 27 launched and have been writing new Captain Hazard adventures. So, I think we reprinted that original cover on the back cover of our first Captain Hazard.
We did.
So, there are tons of amazing treasures that you can find at pulp shows. And again, reiterate what we've said and what Rob, confirmed as well. If you're in the Chicago area between April 21st and 23rd, stop by for an afternoon. Guaranteed you're going to have a good time. You're going to see a lot of fun stuff. And again, a lot of our colleagues, writers, editors are there. We always have a great time at this show.
Yeah, and before we leave that subject, I'm going to say, if you are coming to the area and you want to buy one of our books, let us know if there's any specific book that you want, and I can make sure it's in the boxes that I bring along to Windy City. But you'll need to do that pretty quickly here, probably within a few days after this podcast first goes up on the website. Email us and let us know if there's any specific books you want, so I can order them for the boxes that we're going to be taking to Windy City.
Right. And if you're sitting there listening to Rob's admonition right now and going, okay, so what are the last couple of things you guys have done? Just go to our website.
Yeah.
Just go to our website. It's up to date. Check out all the titles there. They're all available to you. And we love nothing better than having the books that you want at the show. We've just done that, and we can talk about this a little bit. Rob and I have just put together our order of new books that we're having printed to bring to Windy City. And we try at every show to bring the new titles that we've done since the last show. So there's always new stuff at the table. But nothing, Rob, frosts me more than to have fans walk over and look at our 100 and plus books on those tables and ask for the one that we don't have.
which is why if anybody's listening to this podcast and you want one of our books, email us, let us know, and I will order a copy specifically for you, put it aside, and have it for you when you get to the show. We want to sell you the books you want.
Exactly. Amen. We want to make you happy.
Okay. And a nice thing about this is too that since we actually save a little money buying them, taking them ourselves, we actually sell them for less than you can get them on Amazon. So it's like a $2 each discount.
I am really glad you brought that up, buddy. I really am. Yeah, another reason to come to the shows, okay? You can save several bucks on all our titles. It's our way of saying thanks for coming to the show and for the entire pulp community for supporting what we do. So, yep. Okay, hey, I'll take the next item here on our list, which is basically what's out now. And I am really, really happy to say what the answer to that question is Seminar. Finally, okay, we talked at length about this project, and it was finally released just about 2 weeks ago now by the time this show goes live. This is a novelization based on the old Eternity comic book series by Rob and writer R.A. Jones. This pulp novel version was written by Jones. Rob provided the interior illustrations and Ted Hammond the gorgeous color cover that fronts it. At present, May Night, a voice recorder is actually recording it, Rob, for Radio Archives.
Ooh, and a woman.
Yeah, I did. That's cool. Jumped on this rather quickly, and I'm very happy about that, believe me, okay? There was a momentary pause with the book's availability in Amazon, a typical snafu that we run into a little too often these days. But Rob and R.A. cleared that up, and I just want to make it extremely clear to everybody listening to this show, the book is available. It is on sale at Amazon as we're talking now. And, Rob, is the Kindle edition up yet?
You know, I was just thinking of that, whether I've actually – I don't think I've put it up on Kindle yet, so I may try and do that in the next day or so. So by the time this airs, it will be.
Okay.
The Kindle version will be
super.
Up there.
Super.
I think, I'm thinking I did, but I'm not absolutely sure, and I can't check at the moment. But
right.
I believe it. I believe, now that I'm thinking about it, I think I did put it up, and I'd have to go check. But in any case, by the time this airs, by the time it's up, this podcast is up, it will be available as a Kindle. I'll make sure one way or the other.
Yeah, so there you go. The paperback, the Kindle, and as we've said, it is this very talented woman actor is reading it for Radio Archive. So who knows? Maybe by next month when we come back to the show, Rob, the audiobook version could be as well available.
That would be wild.
Yeah, but, no, kudos to Radio Archive's Tom Brown, because believe me, he doesn't let any moss grow under his feet. In fact, just prior to us getting together in the Airship 27 studio here today, they just released their latest Airship 27 audiobook, Rob, which was the audio version of Michael Housel's very popular novel, The Persona.
Yeah. Yeah, I saw the email on that. That's pretty exciting.
Yeah. Yeah. And I contacted Michael immediately, and he's very, very warm for sound about this. So.
Our writers really do like the fact when they go to audiobooks, because it adds a whole other dimension to obviously it puts sound to what they've written. You know, we put it on paper and illustrate it, but now it's actually someone's dramatically reading it as well, and that just adds a whole another level. So,
oh yeah, it's very much a thrill, and if you're one of those millions of people who travel every day, commuting to and from work by train, car, whatever, okay? These are really, really fantastic readings, okay? Again, like as Rob said, Radio Archive uses only the finest voice actors, and they put so much of themselves, enthusiasm and drama in what they read, that it's a really nice way to while away some travel time, all right, and enjoy some pulp action, if you will. So there you go.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Hey, Rob, with Simadar out, what do we got coming up next?
Okay, next in the queue, and this one's been in the queue for a little while, and I'll explain why in just a minute. It's Mystery Men and Women, Volume 4, and here's the deal. We'd hope to have Ingrid Hardy have an Ingrid Hardy cover for this book. But sadly, Ingrid had to bow out due to conflicting obligations she had. She's gotten really busy with some of the commissions and some of the regular work that she's doing. So she had to completely bow out of even working with us, which saddens us, but it also I'm excited for her because I'm always glad to see another creative person get to the point where they turn down business, you know.
No, but so, yeah, no, honestly, we owe Ingrid a huge debt.
Absolutely.
Off the top of my head, I think in the past she's done 4 covers for us over the years.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, we like to brag a little bit, Rob, that we pride ourselves on how our books look to our fans and the community, that we do the best looking new pulp books on the market. And Ingrid was one of the solid reasons why we have that reputation today.
And fortunately, we asked, and he happily said yes. I mean, he said yes, and we were happy to hear it. That Zachary Bruner, another one of those artists that makes us look good, he's able to jump in and handle the cover on this one. And I'm really looking forward to seeing what he does with that. He always does something that's a little off the beaten path, so it's always interesting to see what he's done. And as we record this episode, all that remains is for that cover to come in and we can get it out. It's already been proofread. The authors have proofread it, and I've gone through and looked at it. There's going to be a typo or something we missed, but we've gone over it with a fine-tooth comb, but there's probably a nit that got past us. And so this book features stories by Chris Bell, Joel Jenkins, Thomas Deja, and C. William Russett.
Just to add to that, Zachary Bruner is definitely an exceptional artist with his own unique style.
Oh yeah!
And a while back, he had done complete books for us in the past, i.e., doing interior illustrations as well as covers. And much like all the other artists that we're talking about here, that we've had the honor of working with and the fun of working with. The more we expose them to the community at large and other publishers, happily they get more and more good paying commissions. And so that's what's happened with Zachary as well, to a point where Zachary came back to me and said, look, I may not be able to do interiors anymore because I'm starting to get a lot of commitments set up for the rest of the year. But I enjoy working with you and Rob so much. Please consider me for covers, because I can squeeze those kind of things in between my other commitments. So, knock on wood. Thanks a lot, Zachary. I'm expecting that cover to come into us, Rob, within the next 24, 48 hours.
Yeah, he did say this week, so yeah. And one thing we didn't mention that I will now is I actually illustrated Mystery Men and Women Volume 4. So that wasn't on this little paragraph here, but I did do that. And I used a little bit different technique on this. I have some art markers in different shades of gray, and I used that on these illustrations. It was one of the first times I'd done that, and I was really happy with how those came out. So
yeah.
I'll be interested to hear people's comments on them after they see them. This and the other one that I'd done previously was Custer's Ghost. I also did that way too, using those art markers. So
right.
Yeah, this is a little bit different style than I've been using in the past.
If folks listening aren't familiar with the actual theme of the series, Mystery Men and Women is our showcase anthology series where we allow our writers to invent and create new pulp characters. Initially when we first started issue 27, it was basically to do new stories and anthologies and novels of the classic pulp characters, and we ran that process for God, the first 4 or 5 years we were in business, Rob.
Yeah.
But again, we were getting, you know, all kinds of requests from our writers. You know, I've got an idea for a new pulp hero. I've got an idea for a new pulp hero. And so ultimately, you know, that you and cry was loud enough that we decided, you know what, we need a series to do that, to highlight those particularly. And that's what Mystery Men and Women is all about. This will be volume 4. And as we're talking, Rob, I'm almost 80% filled up on volume 5. So fingers crossed, we could conceivably see that by the end of the year or the start of next year. But it's a fun series, and it's for those readers who want to get introduced to new characters.
Yep.
All right. And then what happens after Mystery Men?
Sherlock Holmes Consulting Detective Volume 9. The ninth.
Yeehaw!
This ninth volume.
You know, I get letters. I get letters, Rob, once a week. When's the next Sherlock Holmes coming out? The next Sherlock Holmes coming out?
Well, here comes this one. The ninth volume in our best-selling series is currently being proofread. It features three regular-length tales by Aaron Smith, Eric Franklin, and I.A. Watson, with two shorts by Fred Adams Jr. for five total new mysteries. As ever, I handled the interior illustrations, and the book features a truly beautiful cover by Adam Shaw. Fans have already begun sending in letters asking when this volume will be available. Hang in there. It's almost done. I don't think we'll have it in time for Windy City. It's unlikely we will. I'm hoping some stuff comes back, and I might be able to get us some copies, but I can't guarantee that it'll be ready for the show.
Right. But not to fret, loyal airmen, because what we will have, and I get in talking Sherlock Holmes here, what we will have on our table at Windy City this year will be the official Holmes and Houdini book with Chad Harden's gorgeous cover. And we'll also have Chuck Miller's original Sherlock Holmes novel, The Picture of Innocence. So we will have some Sherlock Holmes new titles available for you at Windy City. So, you know, as far as Consulting Detective Volume 9, Jamie Ramos is proofreading that for us, Rob, and hopes to have that in within the next couple of days. But then, you know, per our process, that will mean you'll have to sit down and make the corrections of whatever Jamie has pointed out, and then it will go to these four writers for their final look-see and whatever. So,
right.
You know, if we don't have it for Windy City, guaranteed it will be with us at Pulp Fest in Pittsburgh this year.
And I'm hoping, I'm going to Planet Comic Con the following weekend after Windy City. two weekends in a row, big conventions. That's going to be fun. But I'm hoping that I'll have them for that. I'll have a few copies of it for Planet Comic Con. So anybody in the Kansas City area that wants one, come by and again let me know and I'll make sure that I have extra copies in case anybody absolutely wants to have it. So okay.
And wait till you see that cover by Adam Shaw.
Beautiful.
It is absolutely drop dead gorgeous. Okay. Hey, you know, you mentioned the fact that you're doing two conventions, two good-sized conventions, Windy City and Planet Comic-Con back-to-back, whereas yours truly, when I get back from Windy City, we're going to be at the end of the month. And what happens on the first Saturday of May every year, Rob? It's Free Comic Book Day. Yes, which I've had the good fortune and the tremendous fun of being one of the regular guests at the Griffin's Games and Comic Shop here in Fort Collins. And I will be there again this Free Comic Book Day. And I'm really happy that it looks like, if all things go well, I will have the collected edition of our Private Eye comic series that we've done, which is, the series is called Price for the Asking. It was created by me and my good buddy, Bill Gladman. We wrote it. There are three mysteries. We did three issues. The first was illustrated by Brian Latimer, the second by Rob himself, and the third by Barry McLean. And there's even a couple of prose short fictions in there, all dealing with this Detroit Private Eye. Well, as promised, because we put out issue three last year, at the end of last year, we have collected the entire Price for the Asking three-issue series in a graphic collection, and changed the title now to Simon Price, Private Investigator. And Rob has done a new cover for that. He's putting it together, and hopefully by the end of this week, as we're talking, as you're listening to this show, with fingers crossed, this could be available up at Amazon. And why I'm particularly happy about that is because I will be ordering copies, and I will have those on my table at the comic shop on Free Comic Book Day. So there you go.
Yeah, with any luck, I might have some at, I'll be taking some with me to Planet Comic Con. So,
all right.
Fingers crossed.
Yeah, so hey, there you go. We've also got some really, really exciting news on the comic front. Rob, I'll let you take that.
Oh, Brother Bones joins Lucky Comics. Yeah.
Yeah.
Recently, Ron and John Helmer, the publisher and managing editor of Lucky Comics, began discussing an ongoing Brother Bones comic from Lucky Comics. Ron's idea is to adapt the previously published Brother Bones stories in comic book form. To kick off the series, it was agreed Ron would write an 8-page recap of Brother Bones' origin story that would be available for free comic book day. Artist Flavio Silva was signed on to do the artwork, and this small primer, will be done in full color. Look for updates about this on both our Facebook pages, Ron's and mine, and Airship 27, and that of Lucky Comics.
Yeah. So there you go. Again, John and I worked this out several months ago and pretty much kept it under wraps, as you can understand, Rob, until we had an artist on board. And Flavio is somebody who's done work for John in the past. And so I want to say at the start of last weekend, John sent me a few samples of his pages, and they blew me away. I was extremely taken. Flavio is a really, really gifted artist. And John says, so what do you think? He says, Flavio is very, you know, excited about the possibility of taking on Brother Bones. And I said, sure, let him go. Run with it. And today, as we're talking, I've already seen a rough for page one of this 8-page primer. Again, John's plan is to have it fully covered, colored in full color, which is going to be neat. There has never been a color Brother Bones comic before. We've done a 48-page special through Redbud Studio in the past, but we've never seen a color comic of Brother Bones. So, again, this should be ready for free comic book day. And for all of you out there who are Brother Bones fans and we're about to segue into the latest on the Brother Bones movie, let me add this. One of the things that Rob, myself, and the movie producers will be doing in the next couple of weeks is discussing the premiums that we're going to be putting together and making available to the funding program that will be launched to pay for the film itself, to pay the budget and allow the film to get made. So John Helmer's little 8-page full-color primer is most likely going to end up on that premium list, Rob.
I would think so, yeah.
Yeah, so fans out there listening to this and going, well, gee, you know, that's great. He's having it at his, you know, local hometown comic show. How can I get copies of this? That's one of the ways you'll be able to get copies of this little primer. So stay tuned, and we will explain all that as it happens. And with that, Rob, we should segue into that portion of our show, which is the latest updates on the movie production that we receive on a monthly basis from one of the co-producers, Eric Franklin. And as ever, Eric breaks these down into segments. I'll let you take the first one.
All right. Let's see. Number one. Eric says, Daniel and I have engaged some key crew members in the production. We have a still photographer who will be documenting the shoot, as well as shooting promotional behind-the-scenes photos and stills. This is crucial to helping sell the film, and we will be releasing these as soon as shooting begins. Daniel is in contact with a key grip, a classmate of ours, who is so excited for Brother Bones that he offered to work for free. We are now hunting for sound recordists, audio engineers, and a makeup artist who is capable of beauty and horror makeup. We have several possibilities, and we'll be interviewing them soon.
Although he doesn't say specifically in there, one of the things that Eric and his co-producer, the Daniel that he referred to as Daniel Husser,
yeah,
Rod, they're being very meticulous about keeping everything that they're doing recorded, like a day-to-day journal of the process.
Yeah, more or less a blog, yeah.
Right, and so now hiring this still photographer to shoot while the film is being produced, you've done 20 amazingly beautiful colored character sketches for the film, etc. The possibility is very real that once the film is actually released and out to the public, and if it does well, they are considering the possibilities of doing a movie book. You know, one of these things a la The Art of Brother Bones?
Yeah, that'd be cool.
So, yeah, very much so. So, again, it's crucial that they hang on to the material. And again, this photographer on site is really going to be a big help in that process. So, again, all exciting stuff. I'm going to take the next one, which is number two. We are in touch with a talented matte painter who is excited for the project as well. Once the details are ironed out, she will be responsible for several key locations in the film. Her artistic style is photorealistic, essential in the film world today. And we are lucky to have her on board.
Now, that's exciting.
It is. This young lady literally approached Eric and Daniel about Brother Bones because apparently word of mouth throughout the Seattle film and theater community has taken a life of its own, Rob. And so a lot of, again, he mentioned people, they went to film school, et cetera, et cetera. So this young lady does what the old Hollywood artists used to do when they used to paint on glass. Remember, they used to do these matte shots because they'd shoot films in the back lot. It was supposed to be like a giant pyramid. But they can only create the bottom half of the pyramid, and then they'd have an artist paint on glass so that the pyramid rolls hundreds and hundreds of feet in the air. And what they would do is set this glass up in front of the camera by a few feet, and then the actors were below at a distance, Rob, you know?
Right.
So then they would all merge onto the film, and they were seamless. They were flawless. Well, thanks to computers and CGI and all this digital stuff, what we're getting now is a new breed of matte painters who actually paint digitally. And if you read that bit, the key element here is this woman can create images that are photorealistic. So there are scenes in the film itself that would have been impossible to shoot, just technically and practically impossible. This young lady is actually going to paint those scenes, the backgrounds, and they will integrate the live action with that in the computer. And, man, that's just exciting. The imagination behind what these people can do blows my mind.
Yeah, what's really wild about that is when you were talking about the original matte paintings, they were two-dimensional. So you couldn't move the camera and get a three-dimensional view of whatever was being created. Well, with computers, you can actually create a 3D one, so the camera could actually move as well, which is that's an exciting development in that sort of thing.
It enters that world.
Right.
So you can literally rotoscope around like 180 degrees on a set that's make-believe.
Right. Does not exist except in the imagination of the artists and the director. Yeah. Pretty wild.
It is. It's absolutely that. Okay, take the next one.
All right, let's see. Number three. Work progresses on the Brother Bones mask. The sculptor is in regular contact with us, and his initial pass at the mask is very promising. He is now going in for refinements, and then we'll make a mold of the mask. From there, he has to cast it and paint it. There will be two masks for the film. A hero mask for detail shots and close-ups, and a stunt mask for action scenes and the like.
Yeah. Now, you and I, over the weekend, had the privilege and the fun of seeing that mold in process.
Yeah, the gray clay that he's doing it in. He's got it on a mannequin head, and he's forming the mask. And it looks... He did sketches earlier, kind of based on some of the sketches that I did, and it's dead on to his sketch. So this guy's really good.
Oh, totally. Man, when I pulled that up on my PCD screen, Rob, I about fell out of my chair, right? again, trying to make our fans and listeners understand, we've been excited all along since this whole thing started, meeting Eric and Daniel. The thing is, up until seeing that sculpture in process, the mold itself, what we were dealing with was pretty much images, right, Rob? Digital images, sketches.
Yeah, some practice film. They've shot a few practice scenes, but nothing that's real tangible. The costumes that they've used so far are just kind of thrown together from stuff they could find. So, right. But having this that's built specifically for this and to really look like what I drew and what Ron wrote about in Brother Bones is a whole different thing. It's becoming real.
It's tangible.
Yeah, it's becoming real.
It will be the first official prop of the film. And let me add, Rob, again, because anything we do in this kind of endeavor becomes a real learning experience for you and me. When Eric mentions the two different masks, right? I wasn't aware, but apparently the hero mask that the actor playing Brother Bones will wear will have some padding in it, so that if he has to wear it for extended periods of time, it doesn't, so much bruise his face or whatever. It becomes more comfortable for him to have on. Whereas the action mask will be made of a sturdier type material.
Yeah, it'll have to be.
Yeah, so that when that particular stuntman or whoever gets thrown around in a lot of the action sequences in the film, it will endure that kind of punishment. So again, little things that we learn as they progress with this. But stay tuned, loyal airmen, because as soon as the mask is finished, completed, done, and painted, to all our satisfaction, we will be showing to you all over the internet. Trust me, okay? We don't want to keep this under wraps. The more promotion we do, the better it will be for the whole project.
Ron wants everyone to be as excited about this as he is.
Amen. Okay, so here we go for more fun. This is item number four from Eric. Construction has begun on the burnt-out remains of Mount Serenity Monastery. In lieu of relying on too many computer effects, we had opted to make this a miniature set, and we'll composite the actors inside. We will also have the added advantage of being able to film real rain and water effects interacting with that environment. This scene has already been storyboarded and will most likely be one of the first ones shot for the movie. So, I mean, miniature work, Rob. Wow.
I mean, he doesn't say what scale, but I don't know what scale they're going to work in, but that can be it's similar to, I don't know if this is probably not the best example, but the Godzilla films where the guy in the Godzilla costume goes stomping through Tokyo or whichever city he's stomping, and you look at the miniatures and you go, man, that's a lot of work. There's a lot of detail in those to make those look real.
Right.
So,
right.
I don't know what scale they're going to work in, but that's a lot of work.
when they first told me they were going to try that, I was scratching my head going, wow, that's really going out on a limb.
No, it's only one building instead of a whole city like for Godzilla, but still, that's a lot of that stuff, you don't just buy that stuff off the shelf and assemble it. You have to scratch build this stuff.
Exactly. What we're talking about here, folks, is an old Spanish monastery on top of a hill. And somewhere is in the film, and I'm not giving away spoilers, and if I am, you know what? Get intrigued, go buy the books and read about this.
Yeah, it's already been spoiled in the books, so.
The monastery eventually is destroyed, and it's burnt. Now, imagine timbers, half walls, and all this laying up on top of this hill of this ruined old 100-year-old Spanish monastery, and that's what these guys have built on the tabletop. So it behooves it to look real, because if it doesn't, it, as we know, Rob, it immediately destroys the illusion. And Eric says their initial test shots of what they've done thus far with that model have come back very, very positive, and looking like they're going to be able to pull this off. So that's amazing.
They're just—it's amazing that they're doing so many different things. I thought they were going to do most all the effects in CGI, computer-generated imagery.
Right.
But they're exactly. Actually, you know, building miniatures and all this other stuff. So. Yeah, that's that adds a whole nother level to the look of the film, and it should help it feel a little more realistic. Absolutely. So let's see. We're up to number 5 now, I guess.
That's it.
Additional scenes that have been storyboarded, and in parentheses he says, if you feel any of these are spoilers, feel free to omit. And obviously Ron did not omit them. They're actually on the little agenda here. So number 1. The flaming image of Judy emerging from the candle to speak with Bones. Number 2, Jack killing Tommy. 3, Tommy's nightmare with Judy. 4, the werewolf transformation. 5, Tommy and Jack's confrontation in the forest. And these have all been storyboarded. So I think these are some key scenes in the film, and that's usually how you do it. You take the key scenes and kind of storyboard those out first, and then you do the segueing stuff in between. But especially the key scenes like that, you have to make sure everything's choreographed properly. And it's storyboarding really helps you do that. It sets up the camera angles and what you want the actors to do and all that. So it's like storyboarding is very much like storytelling in comic books. And many comic book artists, sometimes they head out to Hollywood and end up being storyboard artists. And
right.
So this will be kind of interesting to see those, because it's very comic bookish.
Yeah. Eric and Daniel have already in the past posted one or two short pages from storyboards. Mm-hmm. And part of this whole thing was, he was curious as to my thoughts, as we said, is whether we should keep these under wraps or show them off to people. And my answer to him was very, mercenary, if you will, in that we do want to keep the excitement up for this project. So my thought was this. Go ahead and show the storyboards, and that's what I'm saying. You should be logging on to either Airship 27, my Facebook page or Rob's, or the Franklin and Husser Entertainment Facebook page, because in the weeks ahead, they will be, Rob, posting more pages, storyboard pages, of some of these scenes. And as I told Eric, look, the people who've read the Bones stories that the movie's being made from, when they read what you just, laid out for us, they're instantly going to remember what that was all about. Whereas those people who haven't yet, all right, this isn't going to so much spoil them as I hope intrigue them, as I said earlier, to want to go out and get the books and see what the heck this is all about. So there you go. Look for that. Coming your way in the near future all over the internet. Okay, number 6. In the spirit of trying new things and innovations, here we go again, I, Eric, stumbled on an idea that will add a great deal of production value and genuine historical authenticity to the production. I managed to find high-quality stock footage, B-rolls and cutaway footage from various small studios from the 1930s. After upgrading and colorizing and retouching some of the scenes, I am pleased to say that we are delighted with the results. The first of these tests that we will be releasing will be an establishing shot of the Grey Owl Casino.
I can't wait to take a peek at that.
So that there you go again. It's this whole thing we talked about with the miniatures and whatever, okay? They have very much eschewed not just doing green screen. They really want to add various elements. So now we have miniatures, Rob. We do have CGI. We have matte shots that are going to be incorporated. And now stock footage that they're colorizing to meet the same palette as the new footage they're shooting and integrating those scenes into the film.
Yeah, that's wild. That is truly wild. They're going all kinds of different new levels.
Oh, totally. Okay, I'll let you take the last one.
All right, let's see. Number seven. That's Eric and Daniel, just acquired a new, more powerful computer for visual effects and rendering on Brother Bones. We are also in the process of camera shopping for an upgrade and are optimistic that Brother Bones will be shot in 4K. This will make it our most detailed film to date. And what he means by 4K is that's high resolution, high definition video. That's the stuff for these really expensive TV sets and the movie theater screens. Those are shot in 4K or even 5K now, which is even more high definition. But a lot of films are shot, the big theater films are shot in 4K. So this that adds just another level of detail to this film. They're going out of their way to really do some. They must be excited about this.
Yeah, well, that's contagious from all of us. And I think the fun, and you and I have known this for most of our careers because we worked in comics where you had the ability to work on a creative project with a team, you know, with an editor, with a letterer, with a colorist, and whatever. And so we're familiar with that kind of thing. Whereas now, working with Eric and Daniel, that's a whole other world for you and me, Rob, all right? And seeing their enthusiasm, which at times not only matches yours and mine, but excels it, all right? And we continuously fire off of each other back and forth all the time, which is, again, the satisfying feeling about what's going on here. There's no doubt in my mind, all right, that Eric and Daniel want to make the Brother Bones movie the finest product they can produce. They are using every single trick that they've learned, not only in film school, Rob, but in the previous two movies that they've produced in the last couple of years. They've learned from working. They've learned from the experiences of what maybe not to do, what to do, how to augment visuals, sound, et cetera, et cetera. And I know for a fact that they're looking at the Brother Bones film as being that step up to another level for them and their company. So, again, very exciting times. And rest easy, Loyal Airmen, because Eric's pretty much now devoted to giving us these updates once a month, and we will continue to share them with you as we go along. Okay, hey, Rob, we have a two-part question, which, as it turns out, is from Eric himself, who wants to know a little bit more about what we do, the publishing world. And so I will read both questions. I'll answer the first one, and I'll let you tackle the second one.
Okay.
All right. So here's what Eric asked of us. Ron, as an editor, how do you decide where the illustrations go in the stories? And two, he asked you, Rob, what do you like drawing the most or least in pulp books? Okay. First of all, that initial question is something you and I have addressed on previous podcasts, but I never tire of saying it for multiple reasons. And again, the question is, how do we decide where we put illustrations in our books, be they novels or in anthologies? And Eric, my answer to that is very simple. We do not decide, okay? And that isn't meant to be, you know, a tricky answer as much as, unlike the original pulp magazines from the 1930s and 40s, which were very much that. They were magazines. They were larger, wider in format, and their pages were done in columns. So it wasn't unusual for an editor to edit pages of a magazine, okay, and find action sequences, go to an illustrator and say, hey, give me a half-page illustration, give me a quarter-page illustration, and lay those out in the stories themselves in the magazine. That's the luxury you have when you do a magazine. Now, try to understand, as much as we're trying to pay homage to the classic pulps in having interior illustrations, we don't have that luxury because in the end, Eric, what we're really doing is publishing a book. And there's a huge difference here, okay? In that, by publishing a book, we have to understand the sensibilities of the entire book itself, the entire package as a whole, artistically, design-wise, how it appeals to the reader. That being the case, early on when Rob and I started issue 27 and I was reading and editing stories and novels, it dawned on me that I couldn't just haphazardly go through a book or a story and go, oh, this is the action sequence. You know, I'll have Rob do an illustration or one of our artists. I want that illustrated. But then the problem with that is I could go 5 or 6 pages later and find another action sequence and say, okay, do that one. But then go 20, 30 pages without any illustrations at all. And if you understand where I'm coming from here, is basically you end up with a very uneven product that looks slapshot, look just thrown together. And that's not what we ever want to do. So the idea with all our books is we want people to take the book, sit down, and start reading through it, and symmetrically understand they're getting X number of pages of pure text. Then they get an illustration. Then, once again, the same almost exact number of pure text. And then another illustration. And that's that symmetry we're after. So what we do is when I get a book in, say a novel, all right, and I know it's going to have 9 illustrations, what I simply do, guys, is I divide the number of pages by 10. Then I go through the book, space, illustration 1, space, illustration 2, space, and I do that till I do illustration 9, and then space the end of the book. And that's why when you pick up any Airship 27 title book, be it a novel or an anthology, the package itself is hopefully has that aesthetic that we're driving for, that it looks beautiful, that the content as well as the cover are aesthetic and pleasing to the reader as they go through it. Now, I bring all this up because recently one of our books got out there and an old pulp fan read it and criticized us for that, Rob. They basically came back and said, well, gee, you have just talking heads here. That's not like the old pulps. You should have had, you know, only illustrated the action sequences. So I hope that particular gentleman gets to hear this particular, you know, episode of our podcast, because we don't have that luxury. We're not trying to put out slipshod products. We want a beautiful looking package, and we do it mathematically. So there you go.
Well, one of the tricks to that, and before I answer the question asked of me, is, and this actually be part of my answer, is that when I get those from Ron, when I'm doing the illustrations, I look for the emotional part of the scene. Now, whether it's an action scene where somebody's punching somebody else or shooting a gun or running or whatever they're doing, That's pretty easy. But then you get into other sequences, there's always something emotional going on in that scene. So you find the emotion in the scene, and then you illustrate that. Sometimes it's very subtle, and other times it's almost melodramatic. So it's a matter of finding the emotion in the scene. And that's what I tell the other illustrators, that's what you need to do. Find the emotion in the scene, and then try and find a camera angle or whatever to make it a little more interesting to look at. So, you know, like occasionally we will get a talking head, but there's something going on in that scene. There's some subtlety going on that this guy is missing. You know, he's expecting, you know, a gunshot or a punch or whatever. And what he should be looking for is the emotion in the scene in that illustration. So that said, now my question was, what do you like drawing most or least in the pulp books? That's a tough question. Because I just explained, I always look for the emotion in whatever scene it is, and that's what I like doing. I like doing subtle emotional things, although there are, if you get a really good action scene, that's a lot of fun too. But you know, everybody likes doing those. I actually like doing those emotional scenes and trying to find the subtleties in that scene to bring those out and you know, bring the person into the story. not just with, and again, not with just the action scenes, but in the emotional scenes between the action scenes as well. And the least, what I like the least, I think I'm like most artists, crowd scenes.
I knew that was coming.
You knew it was coming, didn't you?
Oh, yeah.
Crowd
yeah,
scenes.
Right. So here's the scene, Rob.
Yeah.
Our hero faces off against 200 enemies.
Right. And they each have to be individuals.
Right.
Oh, my gosh. Yeah. Yeah. That, and probably the ones that I find the easiest to do, and this, I guess this is just part of my style, is nature scenes, outdoor scenes. Because I seem to be able to, and I've had several of my fans tell me that they really like those, because they seem to be a lot fresher and easier for me to do. But and so indoor scenes with you know, you have to do all the scene setting. You know, you put the desk here and all the stuff that's on the desk and all this other stuff that kind of set the scene and give you the feel for the particular place that you are. That can be a little, I have to do a lot of research in order to make everything look correctly. But with an outdoor scene, you know, no two trees look alike.
You know,
even two elm trees don't look alike.
Amen.
So, I can draw those the kind of organically and, you know, and just make them fit the scene. Whereas with a telephone from the 1930s, I have to find some reference for what
that
looked like.
Studio A27 work.
It's telling me to go to work. It's that time. It's also telling me we're almost to the end of the hour, too.
Yeah.
So
that's great answer. I really appreciate your answer. Because, again, you know, I love all your work anyways, Robin. You make it all look so bloody easy. But, yeah, I get that, you know, doing the interior stuff, and you do so much of the Sherlock Holmes stuff, I realize where that puts a demand on research for authenticity and stuff like that, as opposed to, you know, you've done some Westerns, like we did the Bass Reeves book, and a lot of outdoor shots on horseback or whatever. So
those are a lot more fun.
Every genre has its challenges. It poses it both to the artist and the writer as well.
Yeah, you're talking about Westerns now. The challenge there is, especially if there's a horse in the scene.
Yeah.
You know, horses are hard to draw. Because
yep.
You have to, because everybody knows what a horse looks like. So if you draw it wrong, they're going to go, that's off. But so you have to get it right. You have to get it right. So I have several reference books and a whole bunch of photos of horses that I, every time I've got to draw a horse, I pull them out and use those to help me get it right.
Yep.
But yeah, I've still got the filing cabinet, but I used to have a filing cabinet full of magazine photos that I pulled out for reference like that. But now I can just type something into Google and I've got it immediately. I don't have to go clipping. The internet has sped up freelance artwork greatly.
Yep. It does the same thing for us writers and researchers.
Oh, yes.
Yeah. Such a handy tool. Okay. Hey, the hour has come and gone as ever. Fastest podcast hour on the internet, I still swear. Rob, anything you want to add before we sign out?
I'm trying to. I had something earlier, and now I've forgotten what it was. I should have written it down while we were going through. It would have been something about Planet Comic Con, which is going to come up the weekend after. Yeah, I can't think of it now. But anyway,
you're going to have a whole bunch of prints, aren't you, at the show?
Well, you're giving me an opportunity to toot my own horn here. I for this show, I'm kind of going all in. I bought what's called a corner table, and it's two tables which is a little larger and a little more expensive. But I also went out of my way to do some color prints. In the past, I've always had these inexpensive $2 black and white prints of Star Trek characters and different things like that. But I actually did some color prints specifically for this show, and they are of the actors who did the Avengers movie. I've got individual prints of each one of them. Thor, Hulk, Iron Man, Captain America, Black Widow, and Hawkeye. And then I've also got a couple of covers that I did for Airship 27. And one of them's in poster form. And that's the Jezebel Johnston cover that I did. Yeah. And then the Holmes and Houdini, I've got that in an 8.5 by 11 print. And then I, at the last minute here, I decided I needed to do one more Marvel print. So I did up, actually I did two. I did Loki as a bad guy for the Avengers. And then I at the last minute, I decided I needed a Doctor Strange. So I did a Doctor Strange one. So, and those haven't arrived yet. I'm still waiting for those to come in, but I've got those all ready to go. They're going to be, I'm going to sell for $10 a piece. And but I'll also have a plastic sleeve to put them in, and I went in all in for this show. So come by, anybody in the Kansas City area or going to Planet Comic Con the weekend of the 27th through the 30th. I think it's that weekend. It's the end of the month.
It's the
end
of April. Of the month.
It's the last weekend of the month. It's 3 days. Come by my table, and I will happily sell you a print and sign it for you. And I'm hoping to do a bunch of original sketches for folks as well. That's always a lot of fun to do at those shows. Yeah. So I'm ready to do all that. So come on down.
Right. Sounds awesome. I still got to make that show one of these days. I've got to work in it somehow, some way. But for right now, again, as everybody in the stands listening to these shows, my mind's on the Brother Bones movie these days. So that's going to take Windy
Cities.
Of my energy.
Yeah, Windy City's up first. So anybody in the Chicago area, come by and see us there. We always have a lot of fun at that show. So please come by and join the fun.
Okay, and Rob, go ahead and sign out.
Well, this is Chief Engineer Rob Davis from Airship 27 signing off.
Okay, and as the captain of the ship, I want to thank Sparky Brant Fowler. Once again, congratulate him on the anniversary of Zone 4. Thanks all of you loyal listeners out there who stop by every month to listen to the show. We really appreciate it. If you have any comments, send them along, please. Thanks again, wholeheartedly. And finally, down ship. If you want me to, I'll count down. Are you recording now?
Yes, I just started.
Okay. Okay, let me count down, and then you take it up, okay?
All right,
here we go. 3, 2, 1.
Hello, Airship. All right, try it again.
Do it again. We got an outtake for Brand here.
Yeah.
Okay.
Try
here
again.
Here we go, take 2.
This has been a Gonzo Goose production.